water and pray for well-being of the whole humanity. Shanti Shanti Shantihi Hari Om Tat Sat. Om Stapakaya Cha Dharmasya Sarvadharma Swarupine Stapakaya Cha Dharmasya Sarvadharma Swarupine Avatara Varishthaya Ramakrishnaya Te Namaha Asato Ma Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Mritangamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Let us bow down to Sri Ramakrishna, the embodiment of all religions, the Supreme God incarnate. Let us pray to Him to lead us from the unreal to the real, to lead us from the darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. In the last class, I have started the topic towards God. What are the practical instructions given by Sri Ramakrishna so that we go onward, forward towards God? In Sri Ramakrishna you find everything practical. There is no theory there. He means what he says. You have to follow. Then only you will be able to move forward in your spiritual quest. Otherwise, you will be stagnant. You will not move. It is just like there's a very nice story in the meditation and spiritual life. Very significant story. Once a group of people wanted to go for boat ride. And they all had sumptuous food and drink, etc. And they went for a ride. They took a boat, all of them were sitting and they were all in a very happy mood. And they started riding the boat. Whole night they have rowed the boat, rowing. Next day morning, because they went in night, you know, they found they had not moved an inch forward. They were there before starting, where were there. The reason was they have not opened the anchor. Because they were in a drunken state, nobody thought of releasing the anchor. Simply rowing the boat, how can the boat move? Same way Sri Ramakrishna here tells. Same way, you may read millions of books. What of that? You may have 20 degrees, academic degrees, master of philosophy, doctorate in philosophy, this, that, Harvard University, Wisconsin University, Michigan University. You may have all universities together, put together. What of that? What of that? You have not moved an inch forward unless you put into practice. Unless you practice it, you won't get a bit of it. You won't get even a trace that song. So, coming to Sri Ramakrishna means you are determined to practice spiritual life. That's the meaning of coming to Sri Ramakrishna. Because all over the street corner there are many people who claim they are saints and holy people, and they make all gestures, they display all powers, occult powers, and they say this and that. They do all sorts of things. They may have little power, I am not denying that. The point is, what do you want to do with those powers? Tell me. You have to do, practice yourself in order to experience the vision of God. And Sri Ramakrishna is assuring you, there is God. What more you want? He is telling that, not simply imagining, not simply quoting the scriptures, but by his practical life. He lived the spiritual life 100%, and he realized the truth. He saw the Divine Mother, he went into ecstasy. And then he's telling, look, I have seen God. That's enough. When Sri Ramakrishna is telling you, I have seen God, you can also see God, but you do like this. Action is important. Action. Otherwise, you will be stagnant. Very important. Very important. So, Sri Ramakrishna is telling you, in the gospel, go forward in your spiritual endeavors till you reach your goal. Never be stagnant. The same idea has been given in the Kathopanishad, which Swami Vivekananda very nicely put in English. Arise, awake, and stop not till the goal is reached. That means, until and unless you see God, you should not stop practicing it. Never stop even for a moment. Never stop even for a fun. No fun in spiritual life. Please note that. If you have to realize the truth, keep the fun aside. What I mean to say is, never stop doing practice. That's the point I want to tell you again and again. Because people forget that. Forget. The more you are practicing spiritual life, it must translate in your behavior. How far you are compassionate, how far you are friendly, how far you are calm and quiet, how far you are cheerful. These are all indications. These are all indications. Otherwise, there is something wrong in your doing practices, or there is something wrong in understanding the spiritual life that you have to correct. You have to make immediate correction. It is possible to make corrections. That's why we always say, have the Guru. Guru is the person who corrects. And he has the sufficient license, I should say, from the Divine Supreme to correct the person, to correct the disciple, what I mean to say. But then, spiritual life starts with your wonderful, intense devotion and love towards the Guru. The Guru may be in the human form. He may be like any one of you. Breathing, eating, drinking, all look alike. But there is tremendous difference. Guru means his life is to be followed. Guru is the one who is moving towards the supreme goal and taking the disciples also along with him. So, to follow the Guru should be easy. If you can't follow independently, because the reason is you won't realize your own faults. That's the greatest danger. Everything is wonderful. Whatever you do is okay. Everything, even the wrong thing is okay, because you are doing it. That is the Maya. That is Maya. So, unless you conquer Maya, how can you have the light of God? Tell me. So, Sri Ramakrishna is telling you, go forward. Never stop, even if you get some results. That's why Sri Ramakrishna gave the example of the woodcutter. As I said in the last class, I have already told the story how he became, because he didn't stop getting into silver mine, sandal mine and silver mine and gold mine. He got into diamond mine also. He became equal to a lot of wealth. Lot of wealth is, his name is Kuber. He became the Kubera because he got diamond, he got gold. What else he wants? So, here, the wealth is God. To reach God is the supreme wealth. If you have it, you are really, truly the richest man in this world. If you get God. Other than that, even though you have got millions and billions and trillions of dollars, you are a beggar. You are not rich. Not rich in the real sense. You may be rich in the worldly sense, but zero in the spiritual sense. Big zero. Capital zero, you can say, if there is any capital. Way of using it. Anyway, that's the instruction Bhagavan gives. How nicely he has given the instruction. Simple way. Simple way of putting the grandest truths. Go forward in your spiritual endeavors till you reach the goal. Goal is to see God. Nothing short of that. And then, well, the next instruction Sri Ramakrishna has given, choose the path which appeals to you. Have faith in it, hold on to it. Very important instruction. Very, very important. Choosing the spiritual path is very important step in your life. Sri Ramakrishna teaches that whatever you do, you will find better and better things if only you go forward. The principle which is true in worldly things is equally or more true in spiritual endeavors also. And he tells a parable to illustrate it, which I have already told you just now. Sri Ramakrishna illustrates how going forward will help spiritual aspirant in the path of work. He says that work is only the first step. It can never be the goal of life. Devote yourself to spiritual practice and go forward. Through practice you will advance more and more in the path of God. With love and longing in your heart, pray to God, O God, grant me devotion to thy lotus feet and reduce my worldly duties. Reduce my worldly duties. People want to work more and more. But here Sri Ramakrishna is telling, reduce, what for? Not for going to club. Not for spending your time in daydreams. But to engage yourself in spiritual practices, you must have minimum duties to be performed. So he says that, pray to God to reduce the duties. Please grant me the boon that the few duties I must do may be done in a detached spirit. Duty means I will do it, it's my obligatory, I must do it. That's all. Whether I like it or not, the question of likes and dislikes should not come there when you are performing the duty. That's the way of practicing detachment. If you go still further in that fashion, you will realize God. That means you will see Him. So by sustained spiritual efforts, this aspirant progress through stages in his path to realization. He will pass through a number of stages. Sri Ramakrishna describes these stages very well in the Gospel. The first stage is that of the beginner. He studies and hears. He loves to read, he loves to hear, he attends all lectures and discourses, he attends many retreats, wherever they are. He runs here, there. That is first stage. It's only beginning. That is, studying and hearing of the spiritual ideas is only a beginning, just a beginning. Second is a stage. More important stage is that of struggling. Struggling. He prays to God, meditates on Him, and sings His glories and name. He struggles. He fights all the opposite forces coming on his way. He resists all the forces. He never stops doing practices. He struggles. He never yields to the weaknesses, even though they may come up, even though sometimes they pull you down and they trample you, even then you rise up. No. I will rather die than yielding. That should be your principle. I would rather die but not yield. That's a very good principle that you should have in spiritual practice. So that is the second stage. Second stage is struggling. If you give way to struggling, gone. Back to square one. You must struggle. Struggle, struggle. If you are struggling, you will see how God's help comes to you in thousand ways. And there is third stage. The third stage is that of the perfect soul. By struggling constantly and by pursuing the spiritual practices, he has seen God and he has realized Him directly and immediately in his inner consciousness. He feels the presence of the Divine in his heart all the time and he is full of joy on account of that. Sri Ramakrishna himself says that, here, do you know what is inside? Divine Mother. He was full of Kali. He was full of bliss. That's why you see Sri Ramakrishna always cheerful. Always cheerful. And last is the stage of the supremely perfect. Like that of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, another incarnation of God. Such a devotee establishes a different relationship with God, looking on Him as His divine master, or as His beloved, or as His friend, or as His mother, whatever way. But you must have definite relationship with God. You can consider God even as Father. If that appeals to you most, have Him as a Father. If it appeals to you that you should look upon God as your own humble mother, your own most affectionate mother, have that attitude. What is needed is, which attitude will take you more quickly, more easily towards the goal? That's important. Swami Vivekananda, again I'm telling, expresses the concept of going forward in his inimitable way. His definition of going forward is that, he says in one of his teachings, it is good to be born in a church, but it is bad to die there. It is good to be born a child, but bad to remain a child. Churches and ceremonies and symbols are good for children, but when the child is grown, he must either bust the church or himself. We must not remain children forever. That means we must not be childish. That's the meaning. And then choose the spiritual path which appeals to you. Have faith in it. Hold on to it. This is another very important practical instruction given by Sri Ramakrishna. I have already told you, Sri Ramakrishna's life means life of practical spiritual life. In him, everything is practical. There is nothing impractical in Sri Ramakrishna's life and teachings. Everything is practical. Everything should be practical. And he is giving this instruction. Choose the spiritual path. Don't simply go on hanging on here, there, everywhere. God is one, says Sri Ramakrishna. But there are innumerable ways that lead to attain Him. God has allowed different religions and creeds to suit different aspirants. People always quarrel over religious differences. Hindus, Muslims, Christians, and among the Hindus, Shaktas, Vaishnavas, Shaivas, they all quarrel with one another. They have not the intelligence to understand that he who is called Krishna is also called Shiva and the primal Shakti, and that it is he again who is called Jesus and Allah. There is only one God and he has 1,000 names. Even we individuals have got 2-3 names. At least I have got 3-4 names. What about God then? All are seeking the same truth. The variance is due to climate, due to temperament and name. All scriptures seek Him alone and nobody else. Anybody referring to God means referring to that Supreme God Himself. The aspirant can choose the path which appeals to him most or as shown to him by his guru. Guru means the spiritual teacher, not your academic teacher. He is also guru in a worldly way. He must have absolute faith in his path. That means the aspirant must have absolute faith in his path and the guru's words. God can be attained through faith alone. Reasoning and doubts push him far away. The person who has faith achieves everything. There is nothing greater than faith. There is a popular saying that Hanuman, the great character in Srimad Ramayana, jumped over the ocean through his faith in Rama's name, but Sri Rama himself had to build a bridge. Give up all such notions as, shall we be cured of our delirium? What will happen to us? We are sinners. One must have this kind of faith. What? I have uttered the name of Rama. I have uttered the name of Jesus. I have uttered the name of Allah. Can I be a sinner anymore? You must have that tremendous faith. Sri Ramakrishna says that we must have childlike faith. The child believes. Here is your uncle. It believes it is our uncle. To illustrate it, he tells the story of a boy named Jatila. The boy was the son of a poor mother. He was to go to school, but he has to pass through woods. One day he told his mother, "Mom, I feel frightened when I pass through woods because I am afraid of wild animals and this, that. I am walking all alone." Then the mother asked him to call on Madhusudan. The child asked, "Who is he?" The mother said, "He is your elder brother." "Elder brother?" So the next time, when the boy felt frightened in the woods, he cried out, "Oh brother, Madhusudan, please come." But there was no response. Then he began to cry, "Where are you, brother Madhusudan? Come to me, I am afraid." The god could not wait anymore. And he appeared before him and said, "Here I am. Yeah, I am your elder brother. Come, I will lead you." He led the boy out of the woods and showed him the way to the school. Such is the response of God to the calls of the faithful. So, one has nothing to fear if one has faith. Sri Ramakrishna has advised us to stick on to one path with all your strength. All your strength must be mobilized in holding on to your path. And again Sri Ramakrishna gives an analogy. A man can reach the roof of a house in so many ways, by the stairs, or a ladder, or a rope, or even by a bamboo pole. But he cannot reach the roof if he sets foot now on one and now on the other. He should firmly follow one path. Either he should go by stairs, or he should go by ladder, or he should go by rope. Whatever way, he should choose one path, then he will reach the roof. Likewise, in order to realize God, one must follow one path with all his energy, with all his resources. He must be firm in one ideal. Dive deep. Otherwise, you can't pick up the gems if you only float on the surface. You must have also the grit to pursue your chosen path till you reach the goal. Grit is important. Grit. Every word is so nicely chosen, as it were. When you need water, you begin to dig a well. But as soon as you strike a stone, you give up digging there and begin at another place. Perhaps you may reach a bed of sand, finding nothing but sand, you may give up that place also. How can you succeed in getting water unless you continue to dig persistently where you have started? And another important instruction Sri Ramakrishna gives you. See, your spiritual valuation is done only when you follow these instructions very clearly and certainly you can value your spiritual life. And here is another instruction Sri Ramakrishna gives you, that is, efface ego and surrender yourself to God. It is Maya which keeps us in ignorance and entangles us in the world and deviates us from our chosen path to divinity. Sri Ramakrishna says that Maya is nothing but egotism of the embodied soul. Egotism is a feeling of I and mine. I am the doer and I am my own master. I can do anything. This egotism has covered everything like a veil. The feeling of I and mine is ignorance. It is of the nature of tamas. It is begotten by ignorance. On account of the barrier of ego, one doesn't see God. One cannot see God as long as one feels, I am the doer. God does not appear easily in the heart of a man who feels himself to be his own master. Ignorance lasts as long as one has the ego, and there can be no liberation so long as the ego remains. Sri Ramakrishna says that all troubles come to an end when the ego dies. Well, I will continue the same subject next Tuesday also. Thank you very much. Page 637. Sri Ramakrishna tells, when you mix with people outside your samaj, love them all. When in their company, be one of them. Don't harbor malice towards them. Don't turn up your nose in hatred and say, oh, this man believes in God with form and not in the formless God. That man believes in the formless God and not in God with form. This man is a Christian, this man is a Hindu, and this man is a Muslim. It is God alone who makes people see things in different ways. Know that people have different natures. Realize this and mix with them as much as you can and love all. But enter your own inner chamber to enjoy peace and bliss. Lighting the lamp of knowledge in the chamber of your heart, behold the face of the Mother, Brahman's embodiment. You can see your true self only within your own chamber. The cowherds take the cows to graze in the pasture. There the cattle mix. They all form one herd. But on returning to their sheds in the evening, they are separated. then each stays by itself in its own stall. Therefore I say, dwell by yourself in your own chamber. It was 10 o'clock in the evening. The master got into a carriage to return to Dakshineshwar. One or two attending devotees got in with him. The carriage stood under a tree in deep darkness. Beni Paul wanted to send some sweets and other food with Sri Ramakrishna for Ram Lal, the master's nephew. Beni Lal said, "Sir, Ram Lal was not here this evening. With your permission, I should like to send some sweets for him by your attendants." Master, with great anxiety, said, "O Beni Paul, O sir, please don't send these things with me. That will do me harm. It is never possible for me to lay up anything. I hope you won't mind." Beni Paul said, "As you please, sir. Please give me your blessing." Master said, "Oh, we have been very happy today. You see, he alone is a true man who has made money his servant. But those who do not know the use of money are not men, even though they have human forms. They may have human bodies, but they behave like animals. You are blessed indeed. You have made so many devotees happy today." 2 days after the worship of Kali, the Marwaris of the Bara Bazaar section of Calcutta were celebrating the Annakoota festival. Sri Ramakrishna had been invited by the Marwari devotees to the ceremony at Malik Street. It was the second day of the bright fortnight of the moon, the festival connected with the worship of Kali, known as the Festival of Light, was still going on at Bara Bazaar. About 3 o'clock in the afternoon, M and the younger Gopal came to Bara Bazaar. M had in his hand a bundle of clothes he had just purchased for Sri Ramakrishna. Malik Street was jammed with people, bullock carts and carriages. As M and Gopal approached 12 Malik Street, they noticed Sri Ramakrishna in a carriage, which could hardly move because of the jam. Babu Ram and Ram Chakravarti were with the master. He smiled at them and Gopal. Sri Ramakrishna alighted from the carriage. With Babu Ram, he proceeded on foot to the house of his host, M leading the way. They saw the courtyard of the house filled with big bales of clothes which were being loaded into bullock carts for shipment. The Marwari host greeted the master and led him to the third floor of the house. A painting of Kali hung on the wall. Sri Ramakrishna bowed before it. He sat down and became engaged in conversation with the devotees. One of the Marwaris began to stroke his feet. The master asked him to stop. After reflecting a minute, he said, "All right, you can stroke them a little." His words were full of compassion. We shall stop here. So, what's your questions? If you have got any questions, you can ask. Whatever they might have achieved, what value has it got as far as truth is concerned? Has it brought peace? Has it removed suffering? I should say they have added to your comforts. That means they are making you more worldly than spiritual. So whatever the achievement is done in the scientific field, from spiritual point of view, they have no value. If you study our ancient saints and sages, they didn't have any lights, but they were very great, remarkably great. And they would go in search of darkness to do meditation. They would go to forest, they would go and stay in caves and practice austerities. And once they realized the truth, they came to know everything about the universe, and they are happy and cheerful. And not only that, they can share that happiness with everyone. That's the beauty of that. The beauty is, you have to come to God to have the real taste of happiness. What all you get, a kind of happiness in the world, is only maya. It's only deluding. It's putting you in some sort of mesmerism. You are under the influence of mesmerism, thinking, oh, it's all wonderful. It is not wonderful. If it is wonderful, you should be always cheerful and happy, but you are not. So whatever the advancement scientifically they have done, more than its use, they are being used in a more negative way, whatever it is. But even if you use it in a positive way, as I said, they are only adding more to your comforts, that's all. That means you are prone to more and more comforts. By that, you are losing your inherent power. Your system becomes so tender, so sophisticated. Without that, you will not be able to manage anything. So you are pushing yourself to that state. And after all, what is the ultimate gain of that? Could you conquer death? Could you know the mystery of life? Could you know what is really true? What is this world for? Nothing of this is solved. So, what is the use of all that? Tell me. Absolutely, there is no use. You may like it. That's a liking. I like to go and swim in the water. Swimming, I like. I may go and swim. What of that? That's all. The point is, have you realized the truth? Have you reached your goal for which you have come into this life? No. Instead of going towards God, you are going away from God. You have wasted whole your life in making laboratory experiments for discovering some material things. Life is gone. And your problems are not solved. That means you are totally in the darkness from the spiritual point of view. That means as long as you are in darkness, you are bound to suffer. Even though he may be a great scientist, he is not free from suffering, he is not free from death, he has not conquered death, he has not conquered his mind, he is prone to all weaknesses. So what? So what kind of life it is? What kind of life? So, I should say, the real life is not started at all for the one who has not taken spiritual path. Real life is not started. That's the truth I am disclosing to you on this day. You may call it in a different ways, you may flower it, you may wrap it in a silk cloth. But truth remains the same. That's all. So, the spiritual, the seekers, they are greater than your scientists. They are greater than your scientists. You see, is it not a great mystery? If you realize God, you will know past, present and future. Not only yourself, everybody. Madhura Babu, when he was about to pass away, some devotees remarked, well, Madhura Babu has served you so much and he has seen you as Lord Shiva and as Divine Mother Kali. So that means he must have final liberation. After this, after he dies, he will get mukti? Sri Ramakrishna says, no. Sri Ramakrishna says, no, no, no. He can't get mukti. They were all stunned. He will have to be born again. He has got that desire, small desire is there. He has to satisfy the desire and then that is the last birth. Swamiji is telling, Sri Ramakrishna is telling, the next life is the last birth for him. And Swami Brahmanji, take the example. He was one of the Gopalas in Sri Krishna's incarnation. And in Sri Ramakrishna's birth, and Sri Ramakrishna's advent, this Brahmanji's life was the last birth for him. He could realize the fulfillment in Sri Ramakrishna. So, like that. You see, you must target it, otherwise you won't get. If you want God, you have to apply your mind. You have to practice. You have to get into it. Otherwise, nothing will happen. Just like the boat example I gave. Anchored boat. We are all like that. Whole day we are doing life. Whole day we are active. Morning to what for? Morning to night. In useless things. From the spiritual value, it is useless. I am telling you. From the material value, you may have $1 million for what you have been doing. But from the spiritual value, it's a trash. So spiritual value is the real value. That's the point which I wanted to stress. Any more question? Yeah. The childlike faith means the child, there it is referred to the simplicity of the child. And the child is so simple, it believes whatever the mother says. So it is referring, the simplicity of the child is incomparable. It is so, that is why the mother is so immediately fascinated by the child's love towards mother is expressed through that extreme simplicity. That is the meaning of having, because it has so much love towards its mother, it believes what mother says. There is no question of doubting there. There is no question of argument there. Mother said, finish, that is truth. You must have that kind of faith. That's what is referred to there. And the other point, you must not be childish, which you say, you don't want to remain child forever. That means, that is the statement which was interpreted by Swami Vivekananda, the disciple of Sri Ramakrishna. The meaning was, don't be ignorant. The child stage is a stage where the child is yet to grow in his intellect and it has to develop its intellect. So you have to provide all opportunities so that the child can develop. But if you don't give opportunities, the child will remain as foolish. And many places you see, if people are not educated, how they behave and how they suffer more because of the ignorance. Though they have got all the capabilities, they were not able to enjoy the life properly because they were not given proper environment, proper training, proper situation so that they could develop. So, that's what he meant there. That's the meaning of telling, it's very good to be born as a child, but bad to be like a child forever. There, the contrast is so clear. As a child, how nice it is. It is guileless, it is sincere, it is faithful, and it is all the sattvic qualities which we describe in Bhagavad Gita. So that aspect is very good to have. But then, the other aspect of the child, that is in unaware of the things and unaware of the situations, remaining dormant, that is called stunted growth. If you don't give a proper conditions, it will not grow. So the meaning there is, develop nicely. Develop in such a way, you embrace the whole world. That's the meaning. And struggling, the idea is, according to the samskaras of the mind, one has to fight, one has to struggle. In one man's case, it's very easy to struggle. In another man's case, it's too difficult. See, he feels, Swamiji, even though I struggle, I have a very bad temper every moment I'm becoming terribly upset, etc. But then, what the answer should be, even though 1,000 times you lose your temper, 1,000 times you struggle. Don't give up struggling. That's the meaning there. Rather, die in the struggling. Prefer to die in the struggle rather than yielding to it. Don't boast, oh, I was anger, so I could do this. Don't jump and dance like that. No. You must repent. Every time you do bad thing, every time you feel it is not good, you must repent for it. Repent and become more strong to fight against it. That struggling should be there. That's what I'm telling you. It depends upon in what way the samskaras are built up in your mind. That's the idea of telling there, struggling, and hold on to one path. That means, otherwise, you will not reach the goal at all if you keep on changing the ways and means. Hold on to one. See, goal is there. I have to reach that goal. So many ways are open. You, before choosing, you look into the whole thing. Have a preview of everything. Then select it. Then go ahead. Then don't waste your time anymore. That's the meaning of telling like that. Any more question? Shall stop. Chant the name of the Lord and His glory unceasingly, that the mirror of the heart may be wiped clean and quench that mighty forest fire, worldly lust raging furiously within. O name, stream down in moonlight on the lotus heart, opening its curb to knowledge of thyself. O self, drown deep in the waves of His bliss, tasting His nectar at every step, bathing in His name that bath for weary souls. Various are thy names, O Lord, in each and every name thy power resides. No times are set, no rites are needful for chanting of thy name. So vast is thy mercy. How huge then is my wretchedness, who find in this empty life and heart no devotion to thy name. O my mind, be humbler than a blade of grass, be patient and forbearing like a tree. Take no honor to thyself, give honor to all. Chant unceasingly the name of the Lord. O Lord and soul of the universe, mine is no prayer for wealth or retinue, the playthings of lust or toys of fame. As many times as I may be reborn, grant me, O Lord, a steadfast love for Thee. A drowning man in this world's fearful ocean is Thy servant, O sweet one. In Thy mercy, consider him as dust beneath Thy feet. Ah, how I long for the day when an instant separation from Thee, O Lord, will be as a 1,000 years. When my heart burns away with its desire, and the world without thee is a heartless void. Prostrate at thy feet, let me be in unwavering devotion, neither imploring the embrace of thine arms, nor bewailing the withdrawal of thy presence, though it tears my soul asunder. O thou who stillest the hearts of thy devotees, do with me what thou wilt, for thou art my heart's beloved, thou and thou alone. O Lord, lead us from the unreal to the real, lead us from darkness to light, and lead us from death to immortality. May all be free from dangers, may all realize what is good, may all be actuated by noble thoughts, may all rejoice everywhere, may all be happy, may all be free from disease, may all realize what is good, may none be subject to misery. May the wicked become virtuous, may the virtuous attain tranquility, may the tranquil be free from bonds, may the freed make others free. May good betide all people. May the sovereign righteously rule the earth. May all beings ever attain what is good. May the worlds be prosperous and happy. May the clouds pour rain in time. May the earth be blessed with crops. May all countries be freed from calamity. May holy men live without fear. May the Lord, the destroyer of sins, the presiding deity of all sacred works, be satisfied. For he being pleased, the whole universe becomes pleased. He being satisfied, the whole universe feels satisfied.